On the 1st of June 2000, Celtic appointed Martin O'Neill as manager. It may be hard for many to fathom now, but at this period in time, Celtic were miles behind Rangers, and had been for a very long time. This was a sliding doors moment for the club. O'Neill's appointment would either see Celtic finally begin to close the gap on their rivals, or if it backfired, the media perception at the time was that Rangers would be on a path to leave Celtic behind, maybe for good. In the time since, it has consistently been Celtic enjoying near total dominance over the other side of Glasgow, and in many ways, this is all thanks to Martin O'Neill. Heading into the 2000-2001 season, Rangers had just won their 11th Scottish League title in 12 years. After Celtic had stopped the Ibrox side from completing 10 in a row in 1998, things went back to how they'd been for the previous 9 years, and after a particularly horrendous season with John Barnes and Kenny Dalglish at the helm, the gap seemed bigger than ever. The Hoops finished the 99-2000 season 21 points adrift of the rivals, and the talk at the time was of Rangers focusing on pushing on and progressing in Europe, as the league title was pretty much always assured. Heading into the new campaign, Italian football journalist Gabriel Marcotti stated, "You can pencil in Glasgow Rangers to win its 12th title in 13 years. Celtic, or anybody else in Scotland, has about as much chance of breaking Rangers' hegemony as Pamela Anderson does of winning an Academy Award." In May 2000, it was believed that Dutch coach Guus Hiddink was set to be named as Celtic's new manager. Hiddink himself admitted he was interested in taking the job, stating, "The people inside the club have to prove they are more concerned with the future than Celtic's past. I know that Celtic is a massive club known throughout the world. They have a great history, but in the eyes of the Celtic officials, Rangers have been the dominant club for too long in Scotland." Hiddink's mind was made up during a marathon 7-hour meeting with Celtic chief executive Alan McDonald. At this point, however, Dermot Desmond, acting essentially as Celtic's owner, stepped in. Desmond insisted on face-to-face meetings with the candidates and staring potential new managers directly in the eye. Desmond met with O'Neill and was so impressed with the Irishman that the decision was made, and Martin O'Neill was the man tasked with turning Celtic's fortunes around as the 21st century began. Despite the disastrous previous season, O'Neill inherited a Celtic squad filled with impressive talent. The likes of Paul Lambert, Johan Mialbi, Jackie McNamara and a young Stylian Petrov awaited. Lubomir Moravcik, though now 35 years old, was a special talent. And most importantly of all, Henrik Larsson had returned from the broken leg, which saw him miss the majority of the previous campaign. O'Neill would make a few additions in his first summer, who would prove crucial throughout his time at the club. Australian Mark Viduka was a fantastic talent, however, attitude problems and a desire to leave the club was the situation O'Neill inherited from the striker. Pre-Henrik Larsson's leg break, he and Viduka had formed an incredible partnership up front, and it would be hard to imagine the club creating a more lethal front too. But Leeds offered £6 million for Viduka, and O'Neill knew exactly what he wanted to do with the money. Just 5 years earlier, Chris Sutton was one of the most prolific goalscorers in the English Premier League, winning a league title with Blackburn Rovers in a season where he netted 21 goals. However, fortunes had been mixed for Sutton in the season since, and a move to Chelsea in the summer of 1999 had been a nightmare. Sutton managed just 3 goals in 39 appearances following his £10 million move to Stamford Bridge. In truth, Chelsea were glad they received the £6 million from Celtic for Sutton, but Martin O'Neill had complete faith in the Englishman. Much media scepticism surrounded the move. O'Neill also broke his habit of not purchasing players following their performance at an international tournament. To much criticism, O'Neill carried out his pre-arranged duties as a BBC pundit for Euro 2000 for several weeks after being named a Celtic manager. During this time, Belgian central defender Jos Velhaeren impressed, and O'Neill spent just under £4 million to bring him to Parkhead. These were to be Celtic's only 2 signings before the first league game of the season. Over at Ibrox, Rangers were spending freely under Dutch coach Dick Advocaat. The Dutchman arrived in 1998 after Celtic had stopped 10 in a row, and in his first season proceeded to spend £36 million. That's the equivalent of £64 million with inflation in 2023. The summer of 2000 saw Advocaat add the likes of Ronald de Boer, Bert Conterman and Fernando Rixon, the squad already including Giovanni van Bronckhorst, Michael Moulds, George Alberts and Stefan Klaus. This was a top quality Rangers side, perhaps stronger and more disciplined and dedicated to fitness than any squad they had in the 90s. Martin O'Neill's immediate attitude to his title opponents was to give them as much respect as possible in the press, repeatedly referring to them as the benchmark. O'Neill did not promise to knock Rangers off any perch, rather stating in his first address to Celtic fans that he would do everything I possibly can to bring some success to this football club. Celtic won their first league game of the season 2-1. Rangers won their first league game of the season 2-1. Celtic won their next three games 1-0, 2-1 and 4-2. Rangers won their next three league games 4-2, 3-1 and 4-1. This meant after four league games each, both sides sat on the maximum of 12 points and they were set to play each other next. August 27th, 2000. Celtic Park, Celtic vs Rangers, the day everything changed. From Martin O'Neill's appointment as manager on June 1st, 2000, everything seemed to be leading to this game. Though not always totally convincing, O'Neill's side had matched Rangers to date, but make no mistake about it, the Ibrox side were the favourites going into this game. Just several months previously, Rangers had hammered Celtic 4-0 in the previous league meeting. O'Neill delivered a pre-match speech to the players that some described as the most motivational they'd ever received. As the game kicked off, Sky Sports commentator Davy Proven stated, "This is a biggie psychologically. A Celtic win today would signal a rebirth under Martin O'Neill. A Rangers victory would let them claim the psychological ground, and they've really had Celtic in a psychological armlock over the last decade." Within 11 minutes, that armlock was broken for good. 50 seconds into the game, new signing Chris Sutton put Celtic 1-0 up. A reinvigorated Petrov made it 2-0 after 8 minutes, before Paul Lambert put Celtic 3-0 up on the 11 minute mark. Rangers were shell-shocked. Celtic Park was in ecstasy. Over the past decade, Celtic did land occasional victories over Rangers. This felt different. This wasn't just starting a game well, it was a demolition of the previous decade. After halftime, Henrik Larsson scored one of the greatest goals in Celtic's history. The Hoops went on to win the game 6-2, including a double for Henrik, and Sutton, who had opened the scoring in the first minute, netted Celtic's sixth goal in the 90th. Celtic were reborn. In his post-match interview, Martin O'Neill, live on Sky Sports, stated, "But at the end of all, and I'm not being patronising, Rangers are still the benchmark and are a top-class side." O'Neill wasn't surrendering the advantage Celtic had gained by saying this. He was instead placing all of the pressure off of his shoulders and onto Rangers. They didn't recover. O'Neill's men went on to win the title by 15 points, maintaining their place at the top of the table from this day until the end of the season. Having shattered Rangers' dominance then at the start of the season, Martin O'Neill's Celtic would break another psychological barrier at the end. On April 29th, 2001, Celtic won 3-0 at Ibrox, their first victory over Rangers at the home of the rivals since August 1994. Just 2 years previously, Rangers had beaten Celtic 3-0 at Celtic Park in May 99 to seal the title. O'Neill had now flipped everything around. And just to round things off, on the 26th of May 2001, Celtic beat Hibs 3-0 to complete the domestic treble. It was the first time Celtic had achieved this since doing so under Jock Stein in 1969. After just one season, Martin O'Neill was already one of the all-time heroes of the club. Heading into the 2001-2002 season, Celtic were now firmly on top, and it couldn't come at a worse time for Rangers. The Bank of Scotland was finally forced to ask Rangers to rein in on the free spending they'd been allowed to do for almost 15 years. Such was the seriousness of their debt crisis. After the 6-2 game the previous season, Rangers panicked and splashed a Scottish record £12 million on Chelsea striker Tore André Flo. Chris Sutton, he was not. The Norwegian spell at Ibrox was not one of success. They were in massive trouble. On top of Sutton and Vilhorn, O'Neill had now added the likes of Alan Thompson, Neil Lennon, John Hartson and Bobo Baldi to his squad. Didier Agathe was bought from Hibs and converted from a striker into a right wing back. Henrik Larsson netted 53 goals in O'Neill's first season, and in the summer of 2001 signed a new contract to remain at the club. The good times were flowing. As a player, Martin O'Neill had won two European Cups at Nottingham Forest. One of his goals at Celtic was to re-establish the club as a force in European football, being put up against Ajax. On August 8, 2001, Celtic travelled to Amsterdam for the first leg and stunned the Dutch side. O'Neill's men scored a 3-1 victory courtesy of goals from Bobby Petta, Didier Agathe and Chris Sutton. The Hoops held on in the return leg to qualify for the group stage proper for the first time. Check out my channel for a detailed look at Celtic's first Champions League group stage campaign, but to surmise, Celtic outperformed expectations. 9 points from six games in a group involving an all-star Juventus side, FC Porto and Rosenborg meant the Hoops finished third. Drop it into the UEFA Cup, Celtic were paired with Spanish side Valencia, only to be eliminated on penalties after exchanging 1-0 wins across the two legs. For the first time in a long time, Celtic fans had pride in their European performance, but they still hadn't played European football after Christmas since 1980. O'Neill's team stormed another title in 2002, finishing 18 points clear of Rangers and recording a then record haul of 103 points. But it was to be the following season when Martin O'Neill's side would really make their mark on the European stage. The 2002-2003 campaign got underway with a disappointing and unexpected Champions League qualifying defeat at the hands of FC Basel. This meant Celtic dropped down to the UEFA Cup, where fans hoped for a strong showing, but few dared dream of what was to come next. As O'Neill had revolutionised Celtic, back in the 80s, it was Graeme Souness who was credited with revolutionising Rangers. After easily dispatching of Lithuanian side Saduva, Celtic were then drawn against Blackburn Rovers, at that point managed by Graeme Souness. Celtic won a tight first leg 1-0 at Celtic Park, courtesy of a goal from Henrik Larsson. After the game, Blackburn captain Gary Flitcroft revealed that his manager had told his players they were much the better team, infamously stating the quote, "The gaffer said it was men against boys out there." As if they needed any more motivation, Celtic went into the second leg at Ewood Park and played Blackburn off the pitch, securing a 2-0 win on the night for a 3-0 aggregate victory. An old rival had been shut up and humiliated, and O'Neill's popularity just continued to soar. The Hoops went on to eliminate Spanish side Celta Vigo on away goals in December, which meant Martin O'Neill had delivered post-Christmas European football to Celtic Park for the first time in 23 years. Another Battle of Britain in the quarterfinals saw Celtic famously record a 2-0 win at Anfield to eliminate Liverpool. Seeing off Portuguese side Boa Vista in a nervy semi-final tie meant Martin O'Neill had delivered Celtic to their first European final since 1970. It was an extraordinary achievement. Celtic were down and almost out before O'Neill arrived. The club narrowly avoided going into administration just 6 years before he arrived at the club. False dawn after false dawn had followed, but now Celtic were playing in a European final. Celtic went on to lose the match 3-2 after extra time to Jose Mourinho's Porto. It was heartbreaking for the fans and O'Neill equally, but the turnaround was amazing. The heartbreak was surrounded by an enormous sense of pride. Martin O'Neill had completely reinvigorated the club. The story continues after this. Celtic stormed another title in 2004, before suffering final day heartbreak in the league the following year. And in Martin O'Neill's final game as manager in 2005, Celtic claim one more Scottish Cup. But the true measure of the turnaround is where Celtic were before Martin O'Neill took over, and their ascent to a European final just 3 years later. Celtic were beleaguered when O'Neill arrived. The fans had been through hell, and the season before O'Neill left Leicester for Parkhead in particular would be enough to make some people just give up. The club were in a seemingly endless cycle of finishing behind Rangers, and any time ground was made, things fell apart. But not this time. Martin O'Neill had not only changed everything on the pitch, but he reinvigorated the Celtic support. They had a hero in the dugout, someone to be proud of, and someone who did everything he possibly could to bring success to the football club. And that he did. In truth, Celtic would have carried on whether Martin O'Neill arrived or not. But if he hadn't, the club's future at that point could have been completely different. There was no guarantee of success, and almost everyone predicted failure. When Martin O'Neill arrived at Celtic, that all changed. Martin O'Neill created the Celtic we know today. Martin O'Neill, in many ways, saved Celtic.